The ones that succeed historically have been the ones that learned how to sit quietly, sit in one place, and there's a reason for that. Welcome to October. We're going to lay out what we expect from this month. And by success, what do we mean success? Let's encapsulate the whole thing if we can. Mind, spirit, mind, is perfectly abstract. It's absolutely sovereign, totally abstract. It decided it wanted to be greater, it wanted to be its own creator, greater than God, you see. So it wanted to change what it was. And it decided it wanted to be concrete, not abstract, but concrete. So it's been imagining this story, a backstory, I call it, of non-abstraction. So we're engaged in this dream, like a storytelling, of the mind not being abstract, being non-abstract, being concrete, at least partially, you see. This isn't true at all. This isn't true at all. The mind, spirit, is totally abstract. There's not a single exception to its functioning whatsoever. It can never be bound by any conditions, any situations, conditions, appearances. Never is it bound to any demand to be something specific. It is absolutely free, as Jesus says. What love really is perfect freedom. Perfect freedom is love. This is the root of creation. This is what we are. We are perfectly abstract. We're spirit. Okay, mind with a capital N, spirit. Imagining itself to not be mind or spirit, you see. And believing that we're concrete in process, time, space, process, and form. We're telling ourselves a story. Now, we might say, well, okay, what's the big deal? The big deal is the continuity problem, as I've always said. The continuity problem means we're so used to seeing mind believing it's abstract. I mean, it's concrete, mind believing that it's concrete, that when mind drops the demand that there be, that mind needs to recognize itself, there's no recognizer, no recognition, and it just is. It knows what it is. Mind freaks out, says, oh, what's that? What's that? What's that? I want to go back to, you know, concreteness. It's called the continuity fear. Now, this is a very, very severe problem. What happened a couple nights ago, spirit was able to drop the demand that there be some recognizer of spirit and just be, and spirit was aware of itself, okay, just self-aware. And it was for an instant, was aware it was absolutely perfect and sovereign over all appearances. Not always sovereign. And I had a reaction, like, whoa, you know, just like, wow. I had to cover my eyes up, like, oh my gosh, so to speak. You know, oh, that's too much, that's too good for me, it's too good for me. But at least I had the experience. I'm aware, this is again, I've had this a number of times. This was more powerful, for sure. So it's absolutely true, the only problem we have is the continuity problem. Spirit is totally abstract. Spirit / mind is totally abstract, perfectly abstract, forever and forever and forever. Nothing can touch it. Nothing can concretize it. Nothing can crystallize it. Nothing can congeal it, you see. It's baseless and traceless. It's pure abstraction. And we've just been pretending that we're not that way. We're different. We're bodies. We're forms. We're concretized. And we have this horrible continuity problem. And it's the only problem we have, because the fact is, we're still perfectly abstract. It's just that we're caught up in this storyline we think we need someone to recognize our abstraction. So we have this concrete hero supposedly being able to recognize our perfect abstraction, which is nonsense. You see, this is just a cover for our desire to be greater than God and our continuity fear, like, oh, we have some story about enlightenment. There's no one being enlightened. Mind doesn't need to recognize that it's perfect. There's no need for mind to recognize that it's perfectly abstract. It is already that way. It doesn't need recognition of this from any source at all. See, reality doesn't need recognition that it's reality. Not at all. And so we have this very, 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 very severe problem. And it's the only problem we have. Because if not for that, we would drop the need for recognition. We would know that mind is perfectly abstract and doesn't need recognition or acknowledgement at all for being what it is. It's created this way. It's inherently this way. Inherent greatness. Inherent greatness doesn't need recognition of inherent greatness. And we are inherently great. This is a fact. And so touching upon this is a very tremendous, it shows progress that spirit mind is making a lot of progress in evaporating the continuity fear, just to be able to be aware for a moment of, without any intermediary recognizer of what I am, I amness, just knowing I am. This is really good fruit on the path, very good fruit. Now, so how was I able to get this far, so far? It's touching upon the ultimate goal. And the answer is evaporating this continuity fear throughout persistent effort. This is how it's done. And what it really means is that you have to get used to more and more abstraction in the mind, more and more abstraction. Get used to it. This is spirit evaporating the continuity fear. And the best way to do this is sitting quietly, sitting maybe in a chair, you could be reading, sitting somewhere. You're not going to be active. You're not going to be doing anything. Now let's say you're sitting here in your meditation and you're allowing to become aware of greater and greater abstraction, total statement, like never and always and impossible. And like Jesus says, this world has absolutely no value for you whatsoever. The only way you will ever be free is to give freedom to everyone else. The only way. It's impossible. These are very abstract statements. They allow for no exceptions whatsoever. So you have to get used to this no exceptions whatsoever abstraction, pure abstraction. And this is gradual. And when you make a shift into more abstraction, you'll just be like, wow, that's amazing, that's incredible, just, oh gosh, I feel like I'm getting close to something perfect, you know. And it will shake you up. And so you have to have a sense of continuity when you have this shift, so you can feel like, you know what, I'm in very familiar surroundings, I'm not going to do anything, I'm not going to be challenged in any way. So we have to drop all sense of like being challenging someone else, challenge this whole idea of competition, challenge, all this. No, you're just sitting here doing nothing. Just sitting here doing nothing. Now, let us say you're sitting here and doing nothing, committed to that, and someone knocks on your door, and so to speak, and says, hey, I have this tremendous mansion for you, and tremendous bank account, and I have all this incredible wardrobe, just, not only that, but unlimited shopping for the rest of your life. Jewels, you know, jewelry, if you're a woman, jewelry. And vacations, I mean, they just offer you the world and everything. No, I'm busy right now, but maybe later. And just, that's it. You just shut the door instantly like that. And so you can just, there's an exercise you can do of someone coming to your door and you're meditating and they offer you, just imagine, what is it they could offer you, you think that could tempt you to stop meditating? And the fact is, your mind is doing exactly that, trying to offer you all sorts of inducements to break away from your abstraction, because that's your continuity fear expressing itself, projecting like a psychic projection and coming back to you, and you feel you're being tempted. And so the discipline is this the vision of oneness? No, I don't want it. My only problem is a continuity problem. I don't have any world problem, I have a continuity problem. The world problem doesn't exist, therefore it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. So, is this offer the vision of oneness? No. maybe later. Do not try to put yourself in a categoric, total abstraction of saying never, because then the ego will start arguing with you. Say, are you sure never, you see? And then you'll start getting shaky. Like, well, so you just say, not now, not now, not now, maybe later. I'm not going to completely categorically rule it out ever, ever, yet, but not now for sure, maybe later. And just keep seamlessly your attention not being pulled, not being pulled anywhere. Staying with abstraction, getting used to abstraction, getting used to abstraction. This is the secret to the success. Either read something or listen to someone or allow the abstraction to just seep into you. And you get more and more and more used to it. This is the only way to succeed. The mind spirit is totally abstract, perfectly abstract, without the slightest exception whatsoever. We are that. We have no choice but to be that. And we are being that now, but we're dreaming that we're not. And this gives a severe continuity problem. But we have no choice but to be what we are, which is total perfect abstraction. So all the efforts we're putting in to believe that we're concrete, we're not abstraction, that we're bound by circumstances, okay, that keeps producing severe continuity problem. That's all it does. And so it delays, and it's very, very unhelpful. So we can know what's helpful. We absolutely can know what's helpful. I was reading something about this perspective, that all humans have different perspective on everything, so you can't really make any absolute statements. Well, that's true on a certain level, absolutely, for the perceptual level. But it is absolutely true, universally true, that we are all spirit. We are all one family of perfect abstraction, and that can never change. That is absolutely true. It's also absolutely true that none of us are bound by any circumstances whatsoever, any situations, any appearances whatsoever. That is absolutely true. None of us are bodies. That is absolutely true. There is no such thing as time, space, process, or form. That is absolutely true. Okay, we all have a very severe continuity problem. Some have it worse than others. Some have worked it out. That is also absolutely true. And if that's the only problem anyone has, that is also universally true. So we actually can speak in terms of universal truths as far as our situation goes. At the level of spirit, now at the level of, you know, personal opinions about the world and perception, well, of course, everybody differs on that. But we're not talking at that level at all. There's no abstraction there. So we can speak in universal terms, absolutely can. And we must get used to this, because what we are is totally universal, total sovereign over all experiencing, all appearances, all manifest and unmanifest. We are always totally free, every moment. We are never bound to any moment whatsoever, never, never. We live in this perfect spontaneity of now. So, this is a synopsis of our situation. We have to get used to more abstraction. Nobody is exempt. No one is exempt. I know there are those who claim, well, you know, this is my role in life, I have to blah, blah, blah. And they think they can claim an exemption. There's no such thing as an exemption. We can't exempt ourselves from what we are. It's impossible. So the less excuses you make, the better. Try not to make any excuses. It's a good thing if you grow up in a strict house where no excuses are accepted. You know, you just learn and say, well, I there can't make excuses really. Okay, October. We're in October now. Already this month has been very intense. I think we're in the third day of October, yeah. Now, Holy Spirit pointed something out to me today that I will share. Very intense. What is extremism? Extreme, radical extremism, fanaticism. What is that? It's to basically say that truth isn't true. That's what it is. It's basically to say that spirit is not perfectly abstract. There are exceptions. That's radical extremism. It's basically to say that spirit is bound to conditions, bound to locations. That's radical extremism. It's denying God. It's denying truth. It's denying reality. You can't get any more radical extreme than that. And this is what this planet is completely engaged in, is radical extremism. The whole planet, this planet, I call it garbage planet. This is where all the tough, hard cases come to this planet. Those who really want to hide from what they are, try to find some deep, dark hiding place so they can never recognize what they truly are, which is perfect abstraction. They come to this world. So this is like an insane asylum, this place, actually. Now, in an insane asylum, if all the insanes say, hey, you know what, we're not insane, not at all. It's the therapists that are insane. Does that mean that that's true? No, it doesn't. So just because everybody's the same doesn't mean that that's okay. You know, insanity is suffering. And having this continuity fear is suffering. And refusing to do anything about it is prolonging your suffering, which is fine. But don't hold that up as some ideal, because it's not ideal. Everyone's free to prolong their suffering as much as they want. But we're also free to bring suffering to an end, absolutely. So you don't want the inmates running the asylum trying to tell everybody that prolonging your suffering is the answer to happiness, you know, and pressuring you. That's not a good situation, because we're fragile. We have a severe continuity problem, very severe. People, we underestimate it. It's incredibly severe. Which is why it can take a long time to evaporate it. It usually does. But time extremely well spent. So we have a world right now. Holy Spirit pointed out to me something very interesting, saying, look, is not the position of the world extremely radical, fanatically radical? For example, they say there is no other place for us to live. Completely insane. What do you mean? Spirit is somehow has no dwelling place other than this world? It's completely sovereign over the entire universe? And you're saying, oh no, it's stuck here? That's bound to conditions. It's not bound to any condition. You can't leave here. You can't go somewhere else. Really? We're bound to our, a location here? We can't go to some other location? Spirit can appear, have an appearance wherever it wants to. If it wants to appear someplace, it can have an appearance someplace. It can have an appearance anywhere instantly. So it's... you're bound to your aging of your body, your sickness of your body. A totally extreme, radically extreme denial of truth. Spirit isn't bound by any conditions whatsoever. Never has been and never will be. If you look at all the positions that this world believes in, you find it just to be the most extremely fanatical radicalism possible. In spirit, in terms of spirit, denying. And they say basically, you're a body, you're stuck here, this is the only place there is, this is your life. None of that is the slightest bit true. So it's speaking lies, as if this, because everybody else is speaking the same lies, they insist it must be true, which is another lie, which is a meta lie. So this world is like one big meta lie, a mega lie planet. Megalithic planet. And so we're dwelling in this most radically, fanatically extreme cult-like planet, sort of an anti-religious cult-like planet, anti-truth cult planet, anti-truth. And when you try to bring truth to this world, they say, wow, we don't want that help. We have a nice hiding place. We're just trying to make it better. We've got a nice little cave some down below, and we just want to put some nice lights on it and have a nice bar. And so we don't want to leave here. No, we want to stay here. So they keep trying to make it, you know, redecorate, put some new wallpaper on the cave. You start feeling jittery. Oh, yeah. You know, let's bring in some new furniture. Let's bring in some better food. Let's get some nicer music. You know, just we don't want to leave this cave. Now, what we have has happened, just happened in the world, as I pointed out in other videos, is this, the world has completely agreed on Southern Sudan, Taiwan, and Kosovo. They all agreed we are going to have a global crusade against radical, fanatical extremism, a global crusade against this. But what are they really saying? What they're really saying is they're having a crusade against themselves. Because they are the ones that they're really crusading against. So what the Holy Spirit told me is, look, the world has just declared war against itself. War on itself. It's like, what a concept. I said, wow. Think about that for a moment. The world has declared war on itself. Against itself. And the Holy Spirit said, this is very bad news. When a planet decides to go to war against itself, this is really not good. So I've been considering this, saying, wow, you know, this is fundamentally spiritually true. Fundamentally spiritually true. When you have a massive crusade against all extremism, all fanaticism, all this, you know, and you yourself are the most extreme fanatical ones of all, which they certainly are, spiritually speaking, you know, from a standpoint of physicality, physical world, like ISIS is terrible, okay, barbaric. At a certain level, they're very barbaric, okay. But Jesus said, don't fear those that can kill the body, fear those that are, you know, out to kill the quote-unquote soul. Spirit. You can't kill spirit or soul, but meaning to drag you down into the belief that you're not spirit. Okay. And so from on that level, speaking spiritually, it's the ones that are, you know, saying peace and security, we have to, you know, establish peace and security on the planet. Those are the real fanatics. Those are the real extreme cultists. Very dangerous. And they literally will war against themselves. They will war against themselves as a great distraction, actually, a great distraction. So when the Holy Spirit put it to me this way, I said, you know, that's very interesting, because it adds up. Like, we become self-destructive. The planet becomes self-destructive. So this could be very much the situation that we're actually facing right now, is a global war against ourselves. The world is fighting against itself, eradicating. But you don't eradicate extremely false positions, which is the position that mind is not perfectly abstract, that spirit is not perfectly abstract. You do not eradicate that through warfare, okay? And this is the issue. This is why the world has taken a wrong step, which is prophesied. The world will take a wrong step. We have many prophets and teachings have said, in the end of this age, the world will take a very much a wrong direction. And it has. It already has taken that, the wrong direction. Because you do not evaporate the continuity fear, which we must do by going to war against yourself. You do not. You don't kill the ego. You don't eradicate this. No, you don't do it that way. The way you do it is to get used to more and more abstraction in a quiet, peaceful way, with a lot of continuity with what you're doing. That's why you see the great rishis, the great seers of the Upanishads, the great realizers of Buddhism and Christianity, and on and on and on, and Islam and other, you know, religions, been great realizers all throughout history. Quiet, peaceful meditation, continuity. What are they doing? You say, what are they doing? They're getting used to greater and greater abstraction in their mind. They may have their eyes closed, but their mind might be going like, wow, there's no exception to this. I see that, I see I'm not bound by any circumstance. No one is bound by any circumstance. First, I am not bound by any circumstance. Then, no one is bound by any circumstance. The universe has never been bound. It's impossible that there ever will be anything. You see, and it gets more and more and more abstract. That's what's going on deep within them. It seems slow and difficult, and it is, because we're so have such a severe continuity fear. But that's what's going on ultimately. And understanding this is being spiritually literate. Okay, you need to be spiritually literate right now. So I'm giving the synopsis, the cliff notes to spiritual literacy here. And then you ask yourself, is that the direction that the world has taken? Did the United Nations, all the countries said, you know what? Our problem here in this world is really a continuity fear, spiritual continuity fear. We were imagining that we're concrete, but we're actually perfectly abstract. So everybody, we have a severe problem in the world of fear. We recognize what it is, and we're going to now begin to bring all our children up. We're going to make a huge program for the whole planet of encouraging us to sit quietly in comfort in a familiar place every day and say our prayers, meditation, contemplation, read spirit, sacred books, abstract teachings, watch abstract videos, read abstract books, you know. In this way, peacefulness will fall upon the planet, and the continuity fear will start evaporating. This is what would actually work. In fact, that's only this will work. Is that what the United Nations decided? You decide for yourself if that's what they decided on. It's a completely rhetorical question, but you need to look into it and consider it. No, they said we're going to go after them and destroy them. You know, we're going to, wherever it is, we're going to root out this evil of extremism, and we're going to destroy it, and we'll make sure it'll never arise again. But the fact is, within us is the fact that we are absolutely, perfectly abstract and cannot be any other way. And this is the very thing that we see as the great enemy. So we have the enemy within us. So if we're targeting, want to get, you know, target extremism and blame the fact, reality for our extremism, we're targeting ourselves. We're really targeting ourselves. The whole planet's targeting itself for being such a terrible place. That's not the answer. That's confusion doesn't solve confusion. Hate doesn't solve hate. Fear doesn't resolve fear. It's freedom that is in action is love, and love in action is clarification and is skillful means, contemplation, meditation, evaporating the continuity fear ultimately is what it's all about here. So do we have a resolution in the United Nations that we resolve, we note, we authorize, the way they do the resolutions, that we're going to tackle this great problem of the continuity fear, and this is the only problem there is. And we know when we resolve this fear, there will be no other problems. We will, because we'll realize we're perfectly free of all conditions. Perfectly free. Everyone is. There's no such thing as spirit being bound by conditions. So it's ridiculous to say I'm a victim of something, right? Ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. So we transcend victim consciousness, essentially. We've imprisoned ourselves in victim consciousness here on this planet, and we're constantly, you know, the Giants playoff game was today, which, by the way, they won, and I couldn't listen to the last two innings because I was too nervous, which means I'm getting older and also smarter. I said, I got to focus on salvation here. I can't be torn apart by all this stress. I forget it. I turned the radio off, didn't listen anymore. But it was supposed to be on television. So I said, okay, but it gave this channel. I said, what channel is that? I couldn't find it. So I was going through every channel on the television set trying to find this channel. FS1. Fox Sport 1, I guess you'd call it. And I went through every channel on the television set. And of course, I saw just a snippet of what's on every channel. And I got to tell you, again, if you want to be truly distressed, just do that. Just go through every channel on the television set. My God. I mean, it just brings me to tears. It's so tragic what's on television. It is such an extreme expression of continuity fear there. It is doing the world such an enormous disservice. And yet the addicts, the continuity fear addicts, which is almost everyone on this planet, feel that they're getting nurtured by this stuff, you know. It is too much to bear, really. The content on there is so, so heavy, so dark, so fearful, so horrible. I said, wow, maybe the Holy Spirit just wanted me to check in one more time with this. Oh my God. Don't watch television. If you want to watch it, play up. You want to watch it, okay. But stay away as much as possible, for sure. Stay away from it. But this just shows you where the planet's at. Okay, a lot of it, where it's at. What people accept as normal. They accept the most extreme continuity fear as if it were normal. As if this was what we're supposed to be feeling. We're supposed to have this fear. There's so much fear being expressed on that television set. Victim consciousness. Attacker, being attacked. Drama, you're right, you're wrong, blame. You know, it's just this huge continuity fear drama being expressed in all its raggedy aspects, you know. And we're supposed to be leaving that far, far behind at this point in history. My God, we've had thousands of years of various religious traditions, you know, really. Maybe the oldest are the Upanishadic Rig Veda, the Upanishads, Judaism is a very old tradition. Some of the mystery religions from Egypt are very old. Buddhism is about 2,500 years old. Christianity is over 2,000 years. Islam is, over 1,500, something like that. And there are other religions that have come on the scene, you know. And we're supposed to be over this stuff at this juncture in the world. We're supposed to be over this stuff. So my contention is you're getting, this is an insane asylum, and you're getting a dump here. This is a dump. And you're getting dumped here from all over the cosmos. It seems like those were the most severe cases of continuity fear have got to be showing up on this planet, you know. And this is what they feel they need. It says, hey, don't leave your cave. You know, in fact, look at the doorway to leaving that cave. Or look, oh my God, it's horrible there. Oh my God, there's violence there. Oh my God, you know, and they fill, you know, the doorway to the cave with all this hideous fear and stuff. You know, so they say, oh my gosh, here, give me another drink. Give me some more medicine. I got to stay in this cave of continuity fear, the cave of continuity fear. Now, the drive to stay in this cave of continuity fear is extreme. It is extreme, and we underestimate it. It's basically serving the vanity of comfort and materiality is what we have here. And those who supply all this drugs, essentially, who supply our fear fix, etc., global corporations in a lot of ways, global politics, all of this stuff, they're marketing, they understand, you know, hey, let's keep these addicts addicted. And so they're hell-bent on that. And I've spoken at length about the troubles that we all are experiencing, because we really, there's a great effort to psychically enslave this planet. And I'm hyper aware of that, very aware of that. And there doesn't seem to be any awareness about this at all in the world, really, very little. Continuity fear is super severe. It's in everybody, male and female, every age on this planet. And those who claim that, what are you talking about? How many continuity fear? Those are the ones who have it really bad. And look out for them, because so in this world you are supposed to be very humble and very repentant. Mood of repentance, which is admitting you have a severe problem. See, the whole thing about repentance is to admit you have a very severe problem. And then the humility comes from that. Say, wow, you know, I'm not some big shot. I got this horrendous continuity problem, which I believe that spirit is concrete and bound by circumstances and process and time, space. And this is totally wrong. And I'm afraid of my spirit, you know, spirit being afraid to accept what it is. And so male and female, okay, there's no exemption. And there's a tendency on this, and the way that this planet unfolds, and I think this is somewhat a cosmic universal situation, is the male female situation is a dance of codependency of expressing continuity fear and say, no, we can't leave this cave. We can't leave this cave. So what I see is the females are very, very, very keen at this time in history on enslaving men, turning men to sex slaves, really. Men, I think most men on this planet are sexual slaves at this point. Almost all. They've been turned that way. So the women use them to get material comforts. Well, let's be honest, this is what happened. This is what happens. And that's the best way. Men are very easily susceptible to that and controlled this way. And they will slave, work, produce surplus, try to make this cave, you know, the nicest place possible. And of course the women say, wow, that's great, this is because I'm so afraid to leave the cave. Now keep in mind, the men also are a party to this. See, you can't blame the women entirely, it's a dance. So the men are willing slaves, you know. They're saying, oh yeah, I want to be enslaved, because I don't want to leave the cave either. The very bad situation. Very, very bad situation. So instead of pointing fingers and saying, who's more to blame? Let's say it's this very toxic dance. And we have to get past that. Absolutely have to get past that. We men cannot be sexually enslaved by women or by other men either. Okay, at all. The best route is celibacy, absolutely. Like in the planets that Jesus has prepared, total celibacy. In fact, there's no sex desire whatsoever. It doesn't even exist. Okay, we have generated a massive amount of attention, fixation on this planet, just to keep ourselves enslaved, actually. Just to keep ourselves enslaved. All this obsession with couture and fashion, and you know, it's just, rarely you see a woman that just dresses plain, you know, just plain, every day. So many you see outfits, and every day is a different outfit. You know, why do we need to be dressing in different outfits every day? Kind of a question. Well, it's to keep this whole buzz of a sexual enslavement going, actually. It's been, you know, we're so used to it in this world that everybody thinks it's normal. It's hideously abnormal. The relation between men and women is hideously abnormal, actually, on this planet. Super toxic. And of course, if anyone tries to get out of that, there's a big fuss and a big blow up, you know, and there again, you got a lot of anger in the relationships, and ultimately the man gets blamed for it. You know, he says, hey, you're supposed to know what your place is and stay there, because the corporate megastructure of this planet, which is all tied with legalism and politics and social, everything, it knows very well that because women have children, women are more interested in acquiring things, getting surplus. They have to. That's understandable, right? Man says, oh, I can just wander off and be a hobo or a bum. This is not a problem with me. I'll just eat berries by the side of the railroad tracks or something. Well, women cannot think like that. They're saying, I've got to get extra stuff. I got to get extra money. I got to get extra rooms, a bigger house. Because I'm having children, you know, and they need hungry mouths have to be fed. So they're wired differently. So of course women are going to say, hey, you can't, you know, you got to do what I tell you to do, which is to provide surplus. And if you're trying to get out of this sexual slavery, psychic slavery, really, which most men are under, psychic sexual slavery to women, the women will create a huge, huge fuss about this. And, oh, you know, try to drive the man psychically unstable. They psychically destabilize the men. And then men start acting out physically in a destabilized condition. And then the woman claims that, oh, he slapped me or he pushed me or something. And then the man says, listen, you're going to have to suffer prison, severe sanctions. And we'll go easy on you this time. If you ever do it again, we'll throw the book at you and your life is finished. This is what's happening. It's psychic slavery on this planet. Very bad. And we might think, oh, well, that's great. Women are doing the right thing because they're getting surplus for their children, raising their children happy, etc. You know, there's no better way to raise your children than a simple life, a simple lifestyle where you have lots of time to be quiet and set the example of quiet meditation, you know, three times a day, prayer at every meal, quiet time at every meal. To have a quiet house, a simple house, where the mother's dressed up simply and very modestly, where the relations between the husband and the wife are very modest and very simple. Okay, they're not all, there's no psychic slavery going on. So we have all these children growing up in incredibly toxic, spiritually toxic environment, both in their house, in their school, in society, in culture, in their friends. And yet they have all these material things, and we think, wow, we're doing so great for our children. Isn't that awesome? We're working men to death. They die 7 years younger than women do. And they work themselves to death because they're under the psychic slavery. They really are. Men don't ordinarily function that way, you know. They have to drink. I remember in this post-game celebration where the Giants, Hunter Pence was like, gave a speech and he was cussing because he didn't know he was on camera. And he apologized later. He said, I didn't know it was live. And everybody's like, oh my God, yeah, you just can't say swear words, you know, it's not good. But they're all upset, like worried. Oh, what if the kids heard that? What if the kids, a family show? But all the while, during a baseball game, not only behind home plate, all the advertising is intensely saturated with hard alcohol advertisements, also with beer advertisements, also with gambling casino advertisements, as well as the in-between commercial breaks are saturated with the most seductive advertising for alcohol, a lot of it hard alcohol. And the people are watching this are like 10, 12 years old, kids, a lot of them. And they don't say anything about that, which is infinitely worse than somebody saying, dropping a couple of cuss words on air. You know what I'm saying? That is how warped our society is. So we're bringing children up in an incredibly toxic environment in this world and thinking we're doing the best thing for them and acting with abhorrence, you know, if any suggestion they might want to change anything. That's right. Want to change anything. Now, I was really blessed because my dad would not allow television in the house. So I grew up my whole childhood, all the way through high school, no television in the house whatsoever. What I do, I spend my time reading spiritual books, contemplating, meditating, focusing on the spiritual path. I had no idea what everyone else was talking about because all they ever talked about was the TV shows they watched the night before. And I ended up off in a corner by myself at school, thinking about this world, like what's wrong with this world? How do we fix it? You know, what's the truth? And studying great spiritual books all the time. It's from the get-go. Even then I had terrible problems. But the thing is, this place is an insane asylum. So it's a pirate ship, you know, really terrible. Maniacs. World of maniacs acts in this place. And they don't even realize it. They think we're bodies stuck in a world, you know, time and space, a process and form. And they think that this is all normal and that our society is normal. It is absolutely so abnormal. You can't even explain how abnormal it is, actually. But the Holy Spirit, God's all compassionate, all merciful, all compassionate, patient, all loving. It's known that we have a severe continuity fear, of course. And that's the only problem we have. And so we have to gradually evaporate it, okay? Gradually, so we end up staying in this hellish place like this, but gradually evaporating it. So from a social standpoint, we don't have to have this toxic psychic slavery in the world, okay? And we don't have to keep drinking alcohol, more and more hard alcohol. I mean, that world's got a severe alcohol problem, actually. Severe drug problem in every possible way because the demand of vanity is off the charts. You cannot give a free rein to vanity in this world. This is what I've seen. I live in a place with extreme vanity. And the fact is, both men and women, but especially women here, they just lose it. I mean, they cannot control their vanity. They simply cannot. It's an addiction. They have extreme trouble with this addiction of vanity and just got to shop and got to look this way and have this car and got to more and never ending demands, and they try to turn themselves into princesses and queens, you know, and it just never ends. They just become, you know, tyrants, you know, vanity overwhelms them. So, you know, so we both men and women have problems that wisdom understands, and you have to avoid those problems at all costs. at all cost. So you need a society that supports this whole healing process of evaporating your continuity fear, not a society that supports increasing your habits and so you have mega bad habits. You don't want to feed the beast of vanity. It turns into a monster, and then the men become nothing more than the means to serve this vanity, really. And you know, it's just, you can just tell, it's like, wow, yeah, the man is nothing more than a slave. He has no spiritual nature. They end up believing the men have no spiritual nature whatsoever, and they're only here to serve women, women's vanity. And this is the way the world is going right now. And we go between that, don't we? The dance, it used to be men say, well, women don't have any spiritual nature. They're so vain and they're only interested in this kind of stuff and this kind of stuff. You know, that's not true. We're all spirit. All spirit. Okay. But you can, this whole dynamic, you know, the whole thing has to melt away. Okay. You cannot keep making it worse, and the whole planet is engaged in making it worse. The whole legal system, the whole situation, this planet is hell-bent on its own destruction, actually, because it's going to attack what's wrong. It's going to attack it. Well, it is what is wrong. You see? It's like this bully with two hands, and one hand's, you know, choking somebody, and the other says, I'm going to take care of this bully, you know, and whack, it chops off its own hand. It doesn't realize it's its own hand. You know, that's doing the bullying. That it doesn't work. You can't, you know, Jesus said, love is the way. Love is the way, which is forgiveness, which is freedom, which is abstraction, perfect abstraction. So he made it very clear that what love really is perfect freedom. And the only way to get perfect freedom is to give perfect freedom to all, extend it to all. Drop all demands that anyone, anything ever appear in any way that you define it for them. I'm defining, you have to appear this way. This is what you have to be for me. Drop all demands and grant freedom to all spirit. And you yourself shall be free. He says, give and ye shall receive. What you give, that's what you get back. Now, it is true that everything on this planet is perfect, exactly what we want. But it is also true that we're desperately trying to keep the continuity fear as strong as possible. Okay, so we're trying to trap ourselves and imprison ourselves and attack ourselves. We claiming that's what we really want. It's not what we really want. It is what we're asking for, so we're getting it. You know, it is what we're demanding of others, that they be imprisoned. So we are imprisoned, so to speak. Self-imprisonment is the only imprisonment there is. Self-victimization is the only victimization there is, actually. But it's not what we really want. What we really want is to be free of this. We want to be free of it. But because of the continuity fear, we just can't snap our fingers and make it happen. Theoretically, of course, we can. But it seems to be very indirect because we're so afraid of recognizing our absolute perfection. We're very afraid of that. I mean, even after all this work I've done, Spirit looked at itself, or was aware of itself for a moment, said, oh my gosh, that's too perfect. And almost freaked out, really. I really freaked out. I just went into some fetal position, you know, in my dream. It's like, oh my God, I can't, this is too wonderful. I can't take this. And this is after a lifetime of effort. So imagine those who spend all their time saturated in, hey, I can't leave this cave. Outside this cave, it's like unbelievably, horrifically terrible. You know, this is the only place I'm. So they're in some fetal position in their cave, drinking and staring at the television, telling them, you know, how absolutely dangerous everything is. You know, and they're generating very severe continuity fear there. And you know, it takes a while. It has to be very indirect for them. You can't just go directly to self, so to speak. It doesn't work that way. So we have October, and we have a situation where the world has declared war on itself. The world has declared war on itself. This is a very, you might call that a dangerous situation in terms of those who still have a continuity fear. Those who don't know there's no danger ever anywhere. It's impossible for them to ever feel be threatened. Perfect innocence is perfect safety. Perfect safety. Know that nobody can ever harm themselves, and no one can any ever put themselves in a dangerous position, actually, because they're spirit. They cannot be touched. No moment can be touched by another. But pragmatically, since we don't believe that at all, we certainly can be put in a pragmatically disadvantageous situation. That is very possible. And we certainly are in one right now, a very disadvantageous position. So, October, what's already come up is maybe we have options, you know, that we can use. Of course we have options, but will we use them is the question. Spirit has infinite options every instant, has all options every instant. There's no option that Spirit doesn't have this very instant. Infinite options this very instant. But because of our continuity fear, we're very circumscribed and think that we only have to have blinders on, you know, so. But we might be able to avail ourselves of several options as possible at this time. Certainly, October has been a good month to me all through. Historically, we've always had breakthroughs, great breakthroughs in October. So I expect the same for this October. We may get a big October surprise in the world, for sure. When the world declares war on itself, there's going to be action. There is going to be action. Now, it's hiding this fact by claiming, no, we're just going after a couple of these radical extremist religious fanatic groups, that, you know, barbarians. But there's way more to it than that. Way, way, way more to it than that. There's this massive enslavement taking place. And, you know, from the standpoint, it's interesting that most of those who have woken up through history have been men. Most. There's been quite a few women, too, have woken up. Those who identify with a male flesh suit, women, those who identify with a female flesh suit, okay. That's what it really is. Because, actually, the situation as a man is potentially a lot worse. A lot worse. For instance, the children, let's say the children of family. Who are those children ultimately going to take care of in their old age? The mother or the father? Most instances, if they had to choose, they'll take care of the mother. Okay, the mother has a much more central role in existence, in society, that's based on generating flesh. Much more central role. You look at, go out the homeless people, you might see a couple of women. I do, there's several. There are some, for sure. But way, 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 way more men are homeless. Society casts off males easily, and I've experienced this whole attitude, is if you're not, you know, a sex slave working for the material comforts of the women of the world, then you don't, in a lot of their eyes, you don't exist. You don't exist. They care less about you. Absolutely care less about you. Won't even give you the time of day. I've experienced this. I really have. It's amazing. You go into shops and stores. When I used to have a little bit of spending money, I tried this out. And if you're spending, how are you? It's great to see you. The women are so nice to you, the clerks, you know. And if you go in there and they realize very carefully, you didn't buy anything, you don't have any money. You walk in there, they might have said hello for 5 years or whatever. You walk in there, they don't even know your name. They look right past you like they've never even seen you. Now Now, in men it's a little different. It's a little different. They'll say, they'll at least acknowledge, say, hey, how you doing? I say, hey, what's up? I don't have much money. They say, I know, I understand, yeah. Yeah, we're not so vicious in that way of being cut off. But men do get cut out of society very severely. There's no question about it. For like my situation right now, I feel like I'd be cut out of society like that. And nobody would lift a finger for me. Not even one finger. Even after everything I've tried to do on this planet, wouldn't lift a finger for me. And so, paradoxically, by spirit wanting to be awakened finally to its true nature, it often chooses a male situation in this world, because you can really experience how terrible this world is from that vantage point. It's easy, actually, because it's very easy for a man to really get stepped on. And they're able to experience, wow, this is such a cruel, vicious, competitive, heartless, compassionless world. This world is merciless. It is really merciless, and it's a really terrible place, actually. And, you know, I think it's much more difficult to get that from a female standpoint, because they often have a big network of friends, people they can talk to. Not all, but often this is the way. Men are often very solitary, easy for them to get cut out, and they just, you know, fade away somewhere, drinking wine by a railroad track somewhere, you know, and they've lost everything. Some court took all their, gave all their stuff to their wife, they're divorced, they're, you know, they don't have much family, the kids won't talk with them, and their health is bad, and they just, you know, drink themselves to death or something. This world's vicious to everybody, but it seems to be easier to experience this viciousness from the standpoint of the male experience, which is why more males have awoken, so those who associate with the male body spirit have woken up, because they say, wow, I better really get after this and find out why am I here in the first place. This is terrible. This is really terrible. It really is. So it's terrible for everyone. And so there are a lot of women, too, who've been stepped on and experienced how terrible it is. And they should get after it also. Meditation, sitting quietly. Everybody should on this planet. But it's not a matter of luck, or it's not happenstance that many men have decided to become very religious, very spiritually focused, said, wow, because it gets real bad for men, really bad. Been through it all. It's amazing. I went through it just to see. Who would help me? Nobody did. Like in high school stuff. I went through so many experiences of complete ostracism to the point where nobody even knew I existed. And nobody cared that I existed in the slightest bit. And I kept testing it out. I go to school and I just say, has anybody going to even recognize me at all? No. I was not part of the, you know, what they felt important or valued at all. Didn't exist. Did not exist. Very harsh. This world can be extraordinarily harsh on you. And, you know, there's just a natural kind of thing with women. People have sympathy. You see someone broken down car inside, or a woman's there, you're going to stop and say, wow, you know, I'm going to help out. You know, there's a problem. But the man, you know, wow, buddy, you might be on your own. Although sometimes men do stop and help out, absolutely. But it's more that way. It's basically, man, hey, you're on your own, you know. Because why? We need bodies. This world values women more because they produce the bodies. That is the bottom line of the whole situation. Men do not produce the bodies ultimately. Okay, so you can have just a few men around and women and produce many, many, many bodies. You don't need a surplus of men, which is why they're sent off to war. Kill them, who cares? You know, it's okay. Life goes on. Bodies continue to be produced, which is in my warfare. You, women and children, you leave them alone, right? You go after the men, slaughter the men, but leave the women and children, because that produces more and more bodies, and we feel we need bodies to identify with. That's how we hide from what we are, by identifying with bodies. However, if you realize all this is completely futile, we can never separate from what we are, and they have no choice but to evaporate the continuity fear. If a culture realizes, then they'll start valuing men. They'll actually start valuing men, you see. And then that helps women out it tremendously, actually, because it changes the whole dynamic of everything. And women can drop their vanity, and they can get after it, too. It helps everybody. But right now, we have a culture that doesn't value men at all. Absolutely doesn't. It views them as all criminals, essentially. What we've done is we've globally criminalized males, men on this planet. Don't value them at all. Why? Because they don't value spiritual truth at all. We value materialistic consumerism, secular materialism, humanistic, you know, consumerism. Consume, produce more bodies. Make this hiding place better, 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 redecorate. So we want people obsessed with form appearances, surface appearances. We want them obsessed with, how do I look? Do I need a makeover? What are my clothes like? You know, how am I smiling right? Am I marketing stuff right? Am I being a good consumer? Am I being a good hider from truth? The planet's obsessed with this. And the old ways are dying out. So it's good for everybody. Everyone has to draw on it whatsoever. You have to allow, spirit has to allow itself to accept what it is. And spirit can't say, well, I'm gonna identify with this male body and I can't do it. I can't do it. See, it's too tough. Or I can't say, I'm gonna identify with this female body. I can't do it. You can't expect that of me. No, I'm exempt from it. I'm exempt. Impossible. Absolutely impossible. So you cannot be exempt. It's impossible. Nobody's exempt. It's absolutely impossible. You cannot just say, oh, I'm this way, and I just can't help myself. This is my role, and this is impossible. I can't do it. So there's no exceptions whatsoever. None. None. There'll never be any exceptions. It's impossible. God cannot make an exception to God. God can't say, oh, there's something that doesn't function the way I created it. That somehow is able to change what it is. It's not possible. So this planet is developing, has got a mega problem on its hands. And mega bad habits are being generated. And it's getting worse and worse. You go through those television channels, you realize it is just incredibly toxic. And on top of all of that, the planet has declared war on itself. So this changes the equation, actually. When a planet declares war on itself, I feel this fundamentally changes the whole equation. Really, it should open up options for us. And so that's why I'm hopeful that the Holy Spirit will have something for us and help us see what our options are. You have an entire planet that's declared war on itself. That's not a good situation. So how do we see our options? By being comfortable with abstraction is the only way. So all these years I've done these videos, and my whole life I've done this, trying to help people be comfortable with abstraction. So all my conversation would always be abstract with people, and they didn't like it. They said, wow, no, what are you talking about? I'm like, that's not helping me be rich. I said, look, it doesn't matter. Being rich in the future is not going to be important. It won't be important. Your real treasures will be your capability for abstraction. That's why Jesus says, don't lay up your treasures in this world. Lay them up in the treasures of the world to come. I mean, get comfortable with abstraction. So you'll know what your options are. So you'll be able to dwell in a place that is highly abstract and supports more and more abstraction for you. So what I found, this world, people have this, like, they've program themselves to react with panic if they hear anything abstract. Really, most people have, fortunate ones are still able to listen to abstraction because they've worked at it. They're not totally out of touch with their intuition and spiritual knowing. But I certainly have tried my whole life to guide all conversations, everything, and say, wow, okay, it's great, but okay, now let's look at some abstraction here. Let's use this time right now to look at abstraction, because you're going to run out of time pretty soon. The world's going to declare war on itself, which it already has. And then what are you going to do if you're completely unfamiliar with abstraction? You can't just pull yourself up by the boots and suddenly dive into just, you know, super great abstraction, because you're completely unfamiliar with that. You think that you're in over your head, you're going to drown, you know. So I said, you got to work at it right now in your lives. And everybody turned a deaf ear. But I wanted to try anyway here, just to find out how bad it is. And plus, I feel like you got to at least try to help others here. I know that there are those who realize it's they knew what's going to happen, and they didn't even make effort because they knew it's wiser to do something else or whatever. I understand that, but for me, I felt, you know what? I just have to try. I don't want to look back and say I didn't even try. But the truth is, people here have developed a phobia for abstraction, abstractophobia, another phobia. A lot of phobias here, abstractophobia. They're terrified of abstraction. They think you're crazy if you talk that way. And of course, with that sort of reactivity that they've worked on and instilled in themselves, how are they going to listen to abstraction? How are they going to evaporate their fear of abstraction? You know, it's going to be a long road for them. It could be a long road. Once you get started, actually, it goes much quicker than you think. But getting started is the difficult part. For sure. Because you see, you think it's going to take 1 million years. That's what you start on the path, you think it's going to take you 1 million years. That's how I felt. Wow, it's going to take me a super long time. But I said, I have no choice, so I have to. And then it ended up, as you go along, you realize, wow, I went much quicker than I thought. And then, wow, maybe it won't take maybe several thousand years. Or then, wow, maybe only a couple hundred years. And then, wow, maybe only 100. And maybe, wow, maybe only 50. You know, it shrinks, the path shrinks as you go along. It shrinks. But getting it started, you might think it's going to take you almost forever to get free of your continuity fear. So I've done what I could do my whole life, and it's been very feeble because people don't want to listen to abstraction. There isn't any other way. You have to. I say, read this, pay attention to this, and Jesus told me, don't bother, don't try to proselytize to people while you're working on this so much, because it's just going to get you into arguments, and he's right. It just gets you into arguments. Everybody thinks they have a better way. You know, everybody thinks they have a better way. Rather than just actually doing the work that needs to be done, which is putting your attention on abstraction. Put your attention on it. So I read these teachings by Jesus, and I say, wow, that's very, very abstract. And it's, you know, stretches my mind. I say, wow, I can hardly stand it. It's so abstract. But if you keep doing that year after year after year after year, now I can look at it and say, oh, it's wonderful. I love it. I feel very comfortable with it. That's how it goes. So you have to challenge yourself in terms of abstraction. Have to challenge yourself truly as a commitment, realizing you have no choice. And for men, they can't get some pretty woman to go to God and say, God, can you get this man off, you know, of his obligation? Can you free him from his obligation just for me? You know, can you do that for me? And of course, the women just tell the men they can do that. So the men will agree then to actually do the same for the women. Say, hey, God, I've done all this tough work. I'll do the tough work, just but let the missus off. She's so nice. You have to make an exception for her. So we both play this game of somehow we're going to get God to make an exception for the other, and then we enslave ourselves to neither one of us doing it. See, neither one of us doing it. You can never do it for another. You cannot force freedom on anyone. You have to give freedom to everybody. And if someone else is not willing to give freedom to everybody, then they're putting themselves behind prison bars. And you can't free them from those. They have to free themselves. You cannot free someone else. They have to free themselves. And you can only advise them and encourage them and give an example to follow. That's it. You can't force anybody, a spirit, to... you can't bind them to anything. You can't bind them to insisting that they must accept truth. We are bound to the way God created us, which is perfect freedom. That's what we are. We cannot escape that at all. But we certainly can pretend that we're not free. We certainly can do that. So the tea leaves, reading the tea leaves of October, already it's shaping up to be the insight's just off the chart. The progress is off the chart. And don't worry about finishing anything here right now, because, you know, sometimes when I'm speaking, I don't even finish sentences because suddenly I've jumped ahead. You know, suddenly clarity opens up more. It's just, wow, this other stuff I was talking about is irrelevant. So don't worry about finishing all this stuff. Keep an open mind to quantum leaps, quantum leaps, quantum leaps, quantum leaps. That, oh, stuff before, it's not so relevant anymore. I see it even more clearly. So we don't have to have dialogues that we need to finish stuff. You know, you don't have to finish anything with anyone, with the world. You don't have to finish anything with the world, actually. You can just see it a different way. And you may suddenly realize, wow, there's no point in that, no point in that. I've given freedom to everybody. I've gone into greater abstraction. And of course, in a spiritually literate culture, we realize that. And people may be talking and they'll just decide, oh, I don't need to keep talking about that, or just stop. And everyone's fine with that. Yeah. Of course, most people think they're stupid. Like, wow, they can't even finish a sentence, a thought, they can't follow through. They don't realize that they shifted into greater abstraction. So we kind of have an upside down world right now that thinks that spiritual people are stupid, and that, you know, and those who are suffering from severe continuity fear are smart. Upside down, backwards world. And of course, those who really, really get it are very humble and, you know, the mood of repentance and humble. And they may have been a lowly position in this world, actually, low status. And no, everybody thinks they're nothing, they're worthless. Whereas the fact is, they may be in a state of tremendous abstraction. And they're going so fast, there's no way that they can get any traction in this world. You know, they don't want any traction, really. And we don't value them. In times gone past, that kind of person is recognized and valued, very much so they're valued. The ones that don't seem to be able to do anything, eccentric, not able to do much, they're in such great abstraction, and they're free, and they're really getting free. And giving freedom to all is what they're doing. They're giving freedom to all. But now, you know, it's like, oh, you look like your status should be that of, you know, picking up garbage, which is what I do, picking up garbage. And people view you as nothing more than you're nothing. You're nothing. You have no value for society whatsoever. Whereas obviously it's just the opposite. Just the opposite. Anybody who has great familiarity and comfort with abstraction is extremely valuable to the world, actually. But the world sees it completely opposite. So, and now the world's declared war on itself. So, October is the month that what do we do as we consider what do we do now that the world has declared war on itself? On itself, actually. What do we do about this world? This world may not be such a great place coming up, right? Not that it's been a great place ever. It's always been a horrible place, but it may become an extremely horrible place now that the whole planet has declared war on itself. My gosh. So it's the time to contemplate and consider. What do we do now that the world has declared war on itself? So we will find the answers to that in this October. That's it.